If you're able to recollect, on October 16th, 2016, I started a series called Kingdom Citizens, and I delivered version 1, where I explained that we are part of a kingdom that is beyond this earth, a heavenly kingdom, and we are subject to a king who rules and reigns over this earth, no matter what happens. On November 20th, 2016, I preached a sermon and I said, Kingdom Citizens, version 2. I released version 2 saying, how do we now live? If we belong to the kingdom of God, how you and I as citizens are supposed to live? And I used the text from Luke chapter 9, verses 57 through 62, where Jesus explains the price of discipleship, the costliness of discipleship, where there are a couple of people, three people come and ask Jesus, I want to follow you. And he goes on and says, birds of the air have nests, foxes have holes, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. A second person comes in and Jesus tells him, and he says, shall I go back and take care of my father when he is dead? And then I'll come and follow you, meaning I will get my inheritance, I'll get all the money, and then when I'm comfortable, I'll come and serve you, I'll follow you. And Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead, meaning let the spiritually dead people take care of the spiritually dead. If you are alive in Christ, you come and follow me. And there's another person who said, oh, let me go and say goodbye to my family, legitimate. And he says, no, unless you lay everything down, unless you even hate your father, your mother, your brother, your sister, and even hate your very own life and lay it down, you are not worthy of me. You're not worthy to be my disciple. That is the costliness of discipleship. In this day and age, we have many Christian church members who warm the pews, but we do not have true disciples, true followers of Christ. That is the problem. And today, I'm going to continue that series and preach to you about kingdom citizenship and explain to all of us what does it mean or how will it look to have the kingdom mindset. Kingdom mindset. And you're going to be asking this question, Pastor, what has this got to do with Christmas? Christmas is the most wonderful time of the year, and I think coming from different parts of the world into this place here in Metuchen Assembly of God, I'm sure we all have wonderful Christmas memories. Back home, if you're an immigrant, you think of, oh, what did I do back home? What are the wonderful, significant memories of Christmas? And if you ask me, because I come from the eastern part of the world, there are a couple of things that stand out for me based on my experience growing up. And one of which is the midnight services. It's like the Christmas service is at 4 o'clock in the morning. We don't get to sleep. We need to sleep early, get up early in the morning, like 3 o'clock. They will get wake us up, and then we got to put on. And that's the only time I get new clothes. So it's so fun to get up in the morning. Because only 3 times a year, probably, I get new clothes. One is Christmas, hopefully New Year. And then when the school begins, we get new uniforms. And of course, your birthdays. If the parents are able to, they'll get us new clothes. But you know how radically things have changed now? Like any day you walk in, you throw away your old clothes, put on the new clothes, and walk out here in America. It's different, but those were the times, because that's the only time we had so much to look forward to, midnight services. The second personal memory for me is we had an artificial Christmas tree in our house, and we always lived within the church campus. So from our house, actually, I can see the church service is going on. And there was this Christmas tree there, and it was fun, and it was Christmas Eve, and the family was all around there. And I don't know what I intended to do. I went near the Christmas tree, and I was, I think, trying to do something. Now, because it's way past that year of when it happened, I do not remember exactly what I did, but I know what transpired after what I did. I set the tree on fire. It just blew up. And it was fired, and then everybody came. All that we do, we can call 911 at that time. There's no 911 there. Just take a bucket of water and just pour it over, and we become the firemen right there in India. And everything was settled. And that is those are a couple of personal memories. And you also would have personal Christmas memories that you can live by. So the reason why I'm choosing what I'm going to be preaching on is, as much as Christmas is about the birth of a child, if there is one festival or one holiday that is celebrated throughout the world, not in one particular part of the world, throughout the world, it's Christmas. It doesn't matter whether you belong to the faith. Everybody loves Christmas. Here in America now, yeah, they started playing the music even before Thanksgiving. And even if you walk into the stores in other parts of the world, they'll be playing, even in India or Australia, they'll be playing Dashing Through the Snow. And then they'll say, oh, it's a wonderful time of the year. Oh, it's so frightfully cold outside when it's so frightfully warm outside in certain parts. They'll be playing those songs. So it goes across the globe. And this is the one, because they all love birthdays. How many of us love birthdays? Everybody loves birthdays, right? We all love to deal with the little child as you're growing up. But as they grow up, then there's a problem. Especially when they hit the teenage, and then after that, it's difficult to deal with some people. Similarly, the whole world loves Jesus as a child. Happy Christmas. Merry Christmas, Happy Holidays, whatever you want to call it. It doesn't matter. But once Jesus grows up and he becomes an adult and he deals with you as man to man, as a woman to woman, then there's a problem. So it starts there as a baby. We all love this time of the year. It's good. It's wonderful to celebrate Christmas. But the most important thing in all of this is the fact that, as we sang in so many of the songs that you did, and I made all of us to sing this particular song, Hark the Herald Angels Sing. If you see the words, born is the King of Israel. How about the other song? Born is the King of Angels. Come, let us adore him. Born here is the King. Do you see how the carols capture this essence that a king is born? Nobody is born a king. They're all born as a prince and then they become a king. But here is someone who is born a king. And that is why wise men from the east were led by a star to travel all the way to Bethlehem and to worship the king with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. So when we are celebrating Christmas, the important thing that we need to consider here is that he is not an ordinary child. What child is this? What child is this? It should blow your mind, because you are going to be standing before a king who is born, and this king is born with a purpose. And the purpose of this king's birth is to die. None of us are born with a purpose to die. Dying is inevitable. It just happens. We all have to die. We all have to physically die. But of course, the only area where we share this purpose with Jesus is that when you and I come into the faith, meaning when you and I come to the knowledge of Jesus, we are called to crucify ourselves, meaning die to our selfishness, our ego, and live for Jesus. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. I have been crucified with Christ, Paul says in Galatians chapter 2:20. The life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who died and gave himself for me. The exchange life is the Christian life. But Jesus, he was selfless. He already died to himself. And he is being born as a king, and as a king with a purpose to die. Now, with this being said, the prophets right through the centuries, and especially when we look at the scriptures, how the birth of Jesus was prophesied. It says that there are around 353 prophecies about Jesus in the Bible, which most of them are fulfilled and some of them are yet to be fulfilled. But in that context, especially with regard to the birth of Jesus, Isaiah the prophet who lived during that time, much earlier to Jesus, he prophesied about Jesus the most, and Jesus quoted Isaiah the most while he lived on this earth. And Jesus' birth was prophesied, and if you want to see, it's in Isaiah chapter 7 verse 14, chapter 9 verse 6 through 7. And the fact that Jesus' birth was prophesied, the reason is this. Because Jesus' birth accomplished two things. Number one, it divided the historical timeline. Number one, it divided history. They called it AC and BC. They said AD and BC, they used to call it, before Christ. And some people became very nervous. Oh, why do you use that name, Christ? Oh, we can't tolerate, everybody needs to accept this. So what they did was they changed it to BCE, before the Common Era. And then they said Common Era after. And we call it AD, Anno Domini in Latin, and it is called the year of our Lord. It is not after the death of Christ, the year of our Lord, AD. So it divided the historical timeline on this earth. Number two, the second thing why his birth is so significant is it was not a normal birth. It was a supernatural birth. It was a supernatural birth. If you look at it in our understanding, the man provides the seed for the baby to be formed. But here, the seed is not provided by the man. And the Bible says the seed, out of the seed of a woman, the child would be born of a virgin. So this is something that should blow your mind, because the one who impregnated Mary was the God of this universe. The Holy Spirit, the Most High, shadowed upon this young girl, Mary, and she became pregnant. And this was a problem at that time. Why? She was engaged to be married to Joseph. And in between, what happens? When you're engaged, you're not supposed to mess up. Engagement is not any sign that, or it doesn't give you the license that you can do what you want. You got to wait for the day of marriage. And that is why Joseph says, when he hears this news, secretly he thought that he should divorce Mary. Because something happened. Maybe she slept with somebody. And that is why now she is pregnant. So we can't deal with this anymore. He wanted to secretly divorce. But what happened? Not only the God who intervened in Mary stopped there, he intervened in Joseph's life and said, listen, you got to accept this, because this child who she is bearing is of God. So go ahead. And just imagine the shamefulness that they had to face in the society, and still they both carried it through and brought the King of the universe into being, Joseph and Mary. His birth was prophesied. His life and ministry was prophesied in Isaiah 61 verses 1 through 3, where he said, the Spirit of the Lord has anointed me to preach good news to the poor, to set the captives free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Then his death is prophesied in Isaiah 53. It's called the chapter of the suffering servant. His resurrection is prophesied in Isaiah chapter 25 verse 8. And also his return and reign is prophesied in Isaiah chapter 11, where it said the wolf and the lamb will be together. There's going to be a new heaven and a new earth. The millennial reign of Christ is going to happen. All this has already been prophesied. It's written. And that is why this word is absolutely significant. Whether you read any other book on this planet Earth while you're living, how much of a knowledge you have, You can read any number of books. You can be the most knowledgeable person. But if you do not know what it is to fear the Lord, you are not a wise person. It said the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Fools despise knowledge and understanding. So Isaiah captures everything for us. Then, there are two significant doctrines of Christmas. When we talk about Christmas, there are two significant doctrines that you and I just cannot escape. And these are sometimes, we say it's a difficult doctrine, but with the help of the Holy Spirit of God, you and I can understand. The first doctrine that I'm going to place before you today that you cannot escape during Christmas is the doctrine of Trinity. I call it the mystery of our God. The mystery of our God. While I was working in India in my first job in my hometown, Chennai, I was, of course, a bachelor, and we had all young people working in this company. It was a computer firm, and it goes way back. I do not know the computer engineers here, whether they know IBM System 400. It's the outdated big systems. I used to work with that. And one day we were in the break room sitting and having coffee, and all the other friends there, some of them are Christians, some of them are non-Christians, they all knew that I was a pastor's kid. And in fact, one day while we were sitting, they made a comment, hey, this guy, he's got a hotline to heaven. He's a pastor's kid. Do you know that? He's got a hotline to heaven. And I think we all have a hotline to heaven. We all should consider to have that. The second thing that they asked me was, one guy, which I've not forgotten even till date, is he just put me on the spot one day. I was in my early 20s, and he said, could you explain to us what Trinity is? And all that I could say at that time is, it's a mystery. It's hard for me to explain to you. That's all I said. It was not a cop-out, but now after living another 20 over years, I still hold to the same idea that it is a mystery. And I'm going to come try and explain this to you. What is this Trinity of doctrine, this doctrine of Trinity, this three beings and one God, three distinct persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and one God? And this doctrine is not explicitly explained in the scriptures, but it is implicit all the way through. And the first example I gave you, God the Father, he impregnated Mary through the Holy Spirit who shadowed her, and Jesus was born. Right there you see Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Take this text, first text, Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 to 3. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was formless and void. It was empty, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the surface of the deep. And God said, let there be light, and there was light. John chapter 1, verses 1, 2, and 3. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. In fact, John could have written, in the beginning was Jesus, and Jesus was God. He just replaced Jesus with the term Word. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Through him all things were made. Without him, nothing that has been made was made. In him was the light of men. In him was light, and that light was the light of men. The light shone in the darkness, but the darkness did not comprehend it. Look at this. Genesis 1, 1, 2, 3, John chapter 1, 1, 2, 3, referring to Jesus being the Word of God. Galatians chapter 4, verse 4, it says, now when the time had fully come, when the appointed time came, it's not the chronological time, it's the kairos time as we read it in Greek. When the appointed time had fully come, When the appointed time had fully come, Jesus was born of a woman. He was born under the law to redeem those under the law so that we might receive the sonship of being children or sons and daughters of God. Galatians chapter 4, verse 4. If you look at the scriptures, you will see the incident in when Jesus was baptized. Jesus was baptized by John the Baptist. And right there you see the Holy Spirit falling upon him, coming down upon him like a dove, and the heavens were open, and they heard a voice thundering from heaven saying, "This is my son." Do you see three distinct beings? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Now, how do I explain this to you? And still say one being. Many people come to you and say, this is the law of non-contradiction apply here. Because you're saying there's one God, does one and three remain the same? No, one is different, three is different. The law of non-contradiction tells us that one and three cannot be the same at the same time. They are two different things. But here we are looking at this mystery of godliness. This mystery where, even in the scriptures, how do I say that it is a mystery? In 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16, if you read, it's clearly said this. Beyond all question, the mystery from which true godliness springs is great. Read it in the New Living Translation. Without question, this is the great mystery of our faith, Paul writes. Christ Jesus, revealed in a human body and vindicated by the Spirit, he was seen by angels and announced to the nations. He was believed in throughout the world and taken to heaven in glory. Even the Bible, the inspired writer Paul, he says, this is the great mystery of our faith. It's a mystery of godliness. And this is what makes our faith stand out from the rest. It's exclusive. It stands out. It's beautiful. It's attractive. Though it's complex. Here you have a Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Yet they live in unity. Yet they live in unity. If I have to do, try to explain to you, I will just tell you what it is not, based on the heresies that prevailed during the early century. Number one, the first heresy is called modalism. Modalism is the way of relating to people, way of relationship. So what does modalism say? They say that, okay, there's one being like water, or one entity like water, and there are three forms of water, liquid, ice, and vapor. No, that means there are just three forms. You're talking about three schemes. It is not that. And this heresy was refuted in the early church. And they said, no, this is not it. They are three distinct persons. And then there's a second heresy called Arianism, where this guy called Arius came in and said, and this is the analogy they provide for that, the sun and the sky. And there you have the star, and then you have heat and gas. You have the stars there. So what happens is, they say the heat and the gas is created by the star. So they compare that and say, God the Father, the star, he created Jesus and the Holy Spirit. So they are created beings. See, that again is a heresy, and this is to be refuted, because as you see, as I showed you in Genesis 1:1 and John chapter 1:1 verses 1 through 3, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So Jesus existed. He was not a created being. Jesus was God. This is where the mystery comes into play. You have to try and somehow grasp this. One of the ways that you can try to do it is, we are all two-dimensional beings, right? And then when you want to go and watch a movie, sometimes you want to have the 3D effect. They give you a glass to put on. And only when you put on the 3D glass, you get the 3D effect. So when you come into your faith, when you accept Jesus Christ to be a personal Savior and put on the 3D glass, the Holy Spirit will reveal to you what a beauty it is and how beautifully they are coordinated and they live together in unity. So it doesn't mean, so there is a faint notion that you can get. And there's a third heresy called partialism. Partialism meaning, they say this three clover leaf, and they say, oh, look at this, it is one, but there are three parts in it. No, they are not three different parts of the same being. So that is called partialism, and that was also refuted by the early church. So the way that I would like to explain to you is this. If you do an MRI of God, it's not magnetic resonance imaging. If you do an MRI of God, I would like you to remember this acronym, this MRI, the mystery of God. M stands for mystery. Our God is a mysterious, relational, and indivisible being. He's always existed. He had no reason. There was no cause. He is the only self-caused being. He has no reason. Nobody else had to create him. He was always there. And think about it. If God cannot be at this level, if he's going to be at that level, he need not be God at all. That's why Trinity sets him apart. He is God. He is beyond us. You and I think of it from the human level, but on a divine level, this happens. And this Trinity was being always in existence because if you say God is love, who was he loving? There was God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit always living in a relationship with one another, loving each other, working in unity. So, number one, he's a mysterious, relational, an indivisible being. When I say indivisible, they are united in community. Why? They are indivisible because when the Holy Spirit is inside of us, God the Father and God the Son are also in there. See, they do not exist apart from them. That is the mystery. When you see God the Son, Jesus said when he was walking on this earth, he said, I and the Father are one. And it is said in John, he said, the Spirit of God, the Spirit, the Holy Spirit will not do anything, will only bring glory to Jesus. They live in unity together. This is the beauty. When you have the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit are there. If you have Jesus, the Holy Spirit and the Father are there. When you have the Holy Spirit, you have God the Father and God the Son right there. They are one being, but they are still three different persons. And that is why our God is a mysterious, relational, and indivisible being. The second doctrine that I want to place before you is the doctrine of salvation, which you cannot escape during Christmas. Why was Jesus born? Jesus was born, very clearly the angel announced and said, you shall name him Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. One purpose, to die for the sins of the world. So if you are celebrating Christmas, if you are not able to hold these two doctrines and celebrate, there is no meaning in it. Only when you're truly saved and your life is in God's hands and you know who Jesus means to you, then Christmas becomes meaningful. You can do all you want. You can decorate the house. You can give gifts. Nothing matters if Jesus does not live inside of you. If he's not captured your heart. If he's not living inside of you, there is no Christmas. If he's not born again inside of you, what's a born again experience? It is the entrance of Jesus into your heart. You are born again, second birth. We sang the song. Born to raise the sons of earth. Born to give them second birth. He was born to give us second birth. Salvation. To be rescued from the dominion of darkness and brought into the kingdom of light. In whom we have redemption and forgiveness of sins. Paul writes in Colossians. He is the image of the invisible God. The writer of Hebrews says, the Son is the radiance of God's glory, the exact representation of his being. After providing purification for our sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty of heaven. He is the image of the invisible God. He is the radiance of God's glory. And now, having said this, I want to bring to you the text for this morning. And this is Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11. Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11. And this passage is called the Christology, the preeminent Christological passage in the Scripture. The preeminent Christological passage in the Scripture. It's called Christology, meaning study of Christ. And this is where I am going to explain to you, how do you have the kingdom mindset? And as I told you, our triune God, who live in community, though they are united in unity, they had a relationship with one another. They're always in relationship with one another. And here when Paul is writing about this, he's writing in the context of having relationships with one another. And this is how he starts in chapter 2, verse 5. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus. In this version it says, in NIV only, it says, in your relationships with one another, have the same mindset or as Christ Jesus. Have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. How do we have the kingdom mindset? He is the king. If you have this mindset today, you're going to be having kingdom mindset. This is the mindset that Paul said that you and I must have. Because you and I are primarily relational beings. Why is it that at the end of one's life, be it even President Obama, if he is in the hospital, who will he look for? Will he look for his Secretary of State or Michelle Obama? He will look for his wife and his daughters because they are relational beings. We need one another. That's how God created the family even before the church. It's an attribute of Trinity to live in community, to live with one another. So this, as I said, the Christological passage, you know, it's wonderful. They in fact sang it as a song in the early church. Imagine singing this as a song. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being and all that. They sang it in Greek. Of course it will sound wonderful. Because that is how it was written. They sang it in Greek. And this is why I usually have this prayer in my heart that God will somehow inspire these hymn writers, the current contemporary songwriters like Chris Tomlin, Matt Redman, Matt Maher, that they will somehow capture this and put it into a song. And that is what they did. In some of the illustrious hymns that some of our young people will never sing, they will sing Cornerstone, which is a very traditional hymn that we have sung always. My hope is built on nothing less. On Jesus Christ, and on his foundation. He is the only corner, he is the foundation. On Jesus Christ and his righteousness. They captured that. So I wish one day this could be captured by one of these songwriters, because this was a hymn the early church sang in glory to Jesus, the triune God. And now you will see how beautifully here Paul gives us in relationship how this Trinity was existing. You will see how the Trinity is existing right here. This is where it starts. It says, your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every other name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow and every tongue confess and acknowledge that Jesus Christ is the Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is the Christological passage. This is it. Look at this. It starts again. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. So I'm going to apply this scripture for you in our, how do we develop this kingdom mindset? We are all citizens of a different kingdom. So how are we going to apply this as a kingdom mindset? The way that we are going to apply this in our kingdom mindset is, number one, willing surrender. Willing surrender. Why do I say willing surrender? Look at this text. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, he was God, Theos. He was God. What did he do? Did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. He was equal in essence with God. He was God. He was seated right there on the throne. He existed, but he did not consider equality with God something to be grasped. That's what it says. Something to be used to his own advantage. But what did he do? Rather, he made himself nothing. He made himself nothing. The word that's used in Greek is kenosis, meaning he emptied himself. He emptied himself of everything that he had, all the glory, the honor, the praise, everything that he was receiving on the throne with the elders bowing before him, the angels worshiping him. He let go of everything and he came down to be a savior to mankind, to die for our sins. Somehow, just try to capture this in your imagination. I do not know how it happened, but somehow when the Trinitarian God were there, when they were seated, when they expected, when they saw, this is what has happened. Somehow they had a plan in place. Even in Genesis 3:15, nothing caught them by surprise. Right there after the fall of man, God said, out of the seed of a woman, the one who will come out, will crush the serpent's head. It's called proto-evangelium. In Genesis 3:15, that's the firstborn. He said, he already made a plan there, and he said, it's going to happen. And it's fulfilled. In Colossians chapter 1, verses, if you read verse 15, it says about that. Where the written code against us was canceled. It all happened right there in the Garden of Eden. It was implemented. Even before that, it was in the thought and in the mind of God. It's a mystery. It's unbelievable. How many times have you heard people say this word, unbelievable? Is it really unbelievable? You see certain thing happening and it is still beyond. It's something that you're not able to comprehend. So at that time you say unbelievable, but actually it is believable. It is logical. It happens. So that's how even Trinity is. Just because you can say unbelievable doesn't mean it is logical. It is explainable that this one God that we have can exist in three beings. And right here you see that God was seated. He did not consider equality with God. So the first point here I'm making, willing surrender. How many of you all know, surrendering is so difficult. You know, people who do not lift their hands in the church and worship God, who feel that, oh no, I don't have to do this. Or people who don't clap their hands, saying, oh, I'm very traditional, I'm conservative, I don't even want to clap my hands. If you have watched the clips of, the college settings where there is a shooter in place and then there's a gunman inside there and then people are all escorted out, you say, everybody, surrender. Everybody surrender, two hands lifted up. Oh, glory to Jesus at that time because your life is in danger, right? Forced surrender. At that time, you will lift your hands. Would you tell the cops, no, I'm not going to lift my hands. I'm a very conservative person. I'll walk like this. Like many of the Indians, we all like this posture. Lovely posture. I'm not going to lift my hands. I'm not going to clap hands and sing. You know, we had issues. You talk about issues here in America of having the piano or the drums. I was in the youth. This is a long time ago. Not very long. But like long time ago in Bethlehem, right? Nice song. But during that time, when I was a youth leader, we used to have a youth service once a month. And there, we will invite the people to clap their hands and sing. And this became very controversial. Oh, this young man, this pastor's kid is asking us to clap hands and sing. We are not supposed to clap hands in the church. We've got to be very serious before God and worship God. Otherwise, God will get us, you know, like all of the starts. But then, this is not a forced surrender. Willing surrender. You know what Jesus does here? Who being in very nature God, he knows that he's God. That means he's perfectly secure in who he is. He knows who he is. He doesn't have to live for another person. He is God, and he chooses to let go of what rightfully belongs to him. Kingdom mindset. If what rightfully belongs to you is being taken, when you deserve that respect and it is not given, would you give up? Would you give up and say, it's okay? God, you are in charge of my life. I know who I am. I'm your child. You're going to take care of me. You will provide for me. I don't have to demand respect. I don't have to demand this. I willingly surrender my life to you. Willing surrender. This is what he did. He willingly gave up his glory. He set aside his glory. Somehow he knew that glory was going to come back to him. But he had a mission on earth. He had to accomplish a mission on earth. And somehow here the Father and the Son had a wonderful understanding that, Son, when you do it, I know it's going to be tough. When you do it, there's something for you to look forward to. So number one, willing surrender. Number two, the second attitude that you should have and that I see in the scripture is costly obedience. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself, humility. He humbled himself, becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Even death on a cross. The most humiliating death a person can die during that time. Even the Romans are never put to death in that way. Excruciator. Out of the cross. Painful death. Becoming obedient. How many of us find it so hard to obey? Our obedience is not easy. We think we want easy obedience. But the obedience that the kingdom teaches us is costly obedience. How many of you all will come and do what the church expects of you to do as long as it is comfortable for you? If it is not comfortable for me, if it runs into my time, if it runs into my wallet, I can't come. I can't do it. Costly obedience. Obedience is costly. How do we implement this obedience? There are only two areas in life. One is time and money. It's in the time. How do you spend your time? How do you spend your money? We use our bodies, this physical body that is going to desecrate, that is going to be dissolved, it is going to perish on the earth. We use our body. That is why this is a temporary tent. We do have an obligation to take care of it, because if we don't take care of it, we cannot do the things that God wants to accomplish through us. How many of you will die for pizza? People will die for pizza, but people are dying of pizza. We need to be careful in what we eat. We need to take care of our bodies. We got to eat healthy, because only if you have good health and strength, you can live for Christ. And you can do what you have to do. You can sacrifice your time. It requires sacrifice of your time. Without sacrificing, you cannot serve Jesus Christ. Let me tell you straight. If you say, I want to serve the Lord, there is no way you can do it without sacrificing your time. And also without sacrificing your money. Costly obedience, willing surrender, but it has to start with costly obedience. You obey Christ. No matter what happens, whatever he said, you don't argue with him. He's God. He's at a divine level. You're at a human level. That is why it's sometimes very hard to comprehend Trinity, because you and I are finite beings. But you can get a notion of what it is. Amazing, how amazing it would be to see this Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And here you see, costly obedience, even death on a cross, he humbled himself. Tell me why it was so costly. Because the greatest prayer, the most difficult prayer recorded in history, recorded in the Bible, was prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane. Because a plan was put into place, Jesus knew it, and it's the only time it said that he profusely sweat blood. He profusely sweat blood. And medical science tells us that unless you are experiencing excruciating stress and tension and pain in your heart, you won't sweat blood. That was the pain that Jesus was undergoing. And you're sweating blood. And you know what happened at the Garden of Gethsemane? An angel from heaven came and comforted him. There had to be a divine intervention. And Jesus prayed, Lord, three times, if it is not your will, if it's your will, let this cup pass from me. If it's your will, let this cup pass. If it's not your will, let me go through it. He said that. And you know what the disciples, we all know what the disciples were doing at that time. And that's exactly what we are doing even now. Sleeping. Wake up, you, the saints, from your slumber. Wake up, you, oh, you sleeper. For the time has come, arise, for the glory of God needs to shine through you. Wake up. Wake up from your slumber and see what's happening around you. America is not the only world. Things are happening in all the places. In India, they're treating the money as demons because they did demonetization. I do not have time to go into it, but then they did something the Indians will understand. So, having said all of this, why? It's costly obedience. You have to obey. And Jesus found it hard, but an angel came and comforted him, and he said, Lord, his last prayer said, if it's not your will that I should, escape from this, I will go through this. He surrendered, though it is not my, it's not my will, but your will be done. And this is what we say in the Lord's Prayer. Let it be done on earth as it is in heaven. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. How many of us really mean that prayer? That God's will should take place in our life. Costly obedience. And number three, after willing surrender, costly obedience. The third thing is, somebody read it for me from there. Very good. Glorious reward. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is the Lord, to the glory of God the Father. A glorious exaltation, a glorious reward for Jesus. After the transaction was made at the cross, there was an elevation. After your pain and after your suffering, there is an elevation. Whatever you're going through, I don't know, but your pain is not in vain. Your pain is never in vain. It is through suffering God accomplishes his glory. I don't know why. It's still a mystery. He could have figured out this plan of salvation any other way. He could have done it, come in like a Superman, boom, boom, boom. He could have got everybody destroyed. Or like a Batman, whatever he did, he could have just finished off everything and he would have settled it and said, this is done. Even now, this flood that happened in our gym, he could have wiped out all of us, right? This water could have come all the way. But then because he had a covenant promise, he said, I will not wipe you out with water anymore, with a flood anymore. Thank God for that promise. Otherwise, it seems it was like a waterfall. Water was just gushing out from the roof, it seems. That's what I heard. But there's a promise in place, and he keeps his promise. So there is a glorious reward for all of us. When you willingly surrender, and when you're Obedience is costly, not when your obedience is easy. That is, I want to make the distinction. Only when your obedience makes you pay a price, there is a reward. If it is coming easily to you, then you're not going to get anything. Because Jesus has to undergo that pain. For some reason, the mystery of suffering accomplishes God's purposes. The mystery, that's why I said, how many of you know our mind is a mystery? You can't comprehend certain things that are happening in your life. You don't know why. You think one way at one point in time, you think another way. Our mind itself is so complex. Just imagine if our mind is so complex at a human level, at a divine level, how God can accomplish everything that is happening all throughout the world and be in perfect control. Willing surrender, costly obedience, glorious reward. And that is what we see in the kingdom mindset in this Christological passage where it said, Jesus, who was in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage, but rather made himself nothing. Made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant. Being found in human appearance as a man, he humbled himself. He humbled himself even unto death, to death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place, to the highest place, that, and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. To the glory of God the Father. Would you receive this Jesus today in your life? Would you receive him and say, God, help me to have this kingdom mindset like Jesus, to willingly surrender, to obey you no matter what, how costly it could be. Because I know one day there is a glorious reward. There's going to be a glorious reward. Have this mindset as that was in Christ Jesus. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. This is kingdom mindset. The mindset of the king is what you and I need to have. A king is born. You're going to celebrate Christmas. Would you celebrate it joyfully, having this kingdom mindset? Having this kingdom mindset. I was thinking of a song that we could sing as a commitment. The song that could closely capture the essence of Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11. And the song, it's a beautiful song that was written by Lenny LeBlanc and Paul Baloche and made very popular by Michael W. Smith. He's called Smitty. He sang this song. If you really mean the song and sing this as a song of commitment today, your heart will definitely be melted. Your heart will definitely be melted. Above all kingdoms, above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. You were here before the world began. Shall we sing this song? Shall we sing the song from the bottom of our hearts and make this commitment and say, make this a prayer, Lord, you are the king who was born for me on Christmas Day. But you are a king who came to die. You are a king who came to die on this earth. Martin Luther King Jr., the civil rights leader, this is how he said it. If a man hasn't discovered something, listen to me again, please. If a man or a woman hasn't discovered something that he will die for, he isn't fit to live. Martin Luther King said this. If a man or a woman has not discovered something that is greater than himself, a cause that is bigger than himself, something to die for, he isn't fit to live. Are you willing to die for something today? Because Jesus was born for a cause that was greater than himself. He was born with a purpose to give us a cause to live with a kingdom mindset. What are the things that you need to die for? Would you keep these thoughts in mind? And if you want to kneel down and sing at your place, I welcome you to do it. If you want to come to the altar, kneel down and sing this song, I welcome you to do it. Whatever it is, but I want you to bow down, bend down your knee. Bend down your knee today. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every other name. Every other name. That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Would you please bend down your knees today? Would you forget about yourself and sing this song as a song of commitment so that you can experience the true meaning of the birth of Christ?